Bless the Lord, oh my soul. If you're looking for a seat, if you got some seats next to you, then just put your hand up. Give us a wave. You can access either side. There's some down the front if you those want to sit down. Amen. Wow, well, it's so good to see you today on this Resurrection Sunday. I tell you, the amount of people awake, I was like, what? This is crazy. But I tell you, it's so good to be in the house of the Lord together. Amen? And I want to give a big welcome to our guys watching by YouTube live stream. Bless you guys. Welcome. So good to have you with us. Any first-time visitors with us, just put your hand up. If this is your first time at Hillview, we'd love to welcome you. Welcome. Let's welcome these guys. Welcome. I know we have some guys from Brisbane with us. I was at their church last week, Glory City. That was awesome. And so welcome from Brisbane. And yeah, it's amazing. I tell you, these last 2 weeks has just been a phenomenal 2 weeks. Before we get into any notices, I just want to give a testimony on School of the Prophets. I tell you, this place is rocking here every Thursday night. And people, we have 50-odd people here every Thursday night, and then 23, I think, online. And I tell you, we're in our second week, and already the testimonies are coming of how people feel so activated straight away. It's like God has activated them. And one woman came up to me and said, Gary, I've never lived like this. I've never lived with the intentionality of just being, you know, a vessel and being a vehicle for God's kindness. And I want to encourage you that guys, we can do that without even opening our mouths. We can even do that with not even, quote-unquote, prophesying like I feel like the Lord wants to encourage you. Let me tell you something. Yesterday, we went down to, down near that way. I tell you, I'm still, Somerville. Is it called Somerville? Is it down that way? Somerville. We were down in Somerville. And so we were with the Allisons, and they send their love. Steve's going away to Hong Kong, I believe, tomorrow. So they're having some family time this morning. But we were with them yesterday, and we went to this cafe. And I'll tell you, how many people have ever experienced this when it's like you are just arrested by His compassion for someone? And so we walked into this cafe, and I'll tell you, guys, it wasn't vue du monde, and it wasn't, you know, anything special, but you could see the heart of this woman, and she had a young child there with her. He's probably 12, 13, and I won't tell you the name, but as we walked in, you could see she just become overwhelmed, that she was there by herself. And as soon as I looked at her, the Lord said, I want you to change your atmosphere. And so the first thing I said to her, I said, how is your day going? And she said, oh, well, I just feel so overwhelmed, because I'm on my own and I have my son, and I didn't expect this many people. There was about, you know, 6 or 7 of us there. And I said, you can do this. I said, you're amazing. You can do this. And every time I went to ask a question, I blessed her. I said, you're amazing. You're amazing. And literally, Steve's like, dude, her countenance is changing. From when we first entered, literally bit by bit, her countenance changed. And you could see that every time I released just an encouragement, just, hey, you're awesome. This is amazing. And, you know, I'm sitting there, I'm like, do you know what I'd love to do? I'd love to just take her away for a weekend and get a bunch of people in there and do that cafe over. You know, rip all the stuff out and put, like, everything, like, paint and put a new, you know, worktop in there, put a new kitchen in there. And I'm thinking, because this woman, Sakura, she used to be a chef at one of the top restaurants in Melbourne. And she gave all that up because she fell pregnant with this boy. And I was like, just the compassion of God. And so at the end of it, you know, she totaled it all up and it came to X amount. And I give her over and above what it came to. And I said, please keep the change. She started weeping. You can change atmospheres by just being you and being generous. I didn't turn around and say, hey, I'm a Christian, I'm a pastor, can I pray for you? I didn't say, hey, I just feel the Lord wants to say. I was deliberate and intentional in just being good. Amen? Because God is good and his love endures forever. Amen? And so I want to encourage you. And this is what I love about Thursday nights. We're not teaching guys the how. We're teaching them the why. Because when you find the why, you'll know the how. You see, purpose always precedes presence. And when you find his presence, you find his purpose. Amen? Amen? Awesome. Where's my dear wife? Here she comes. Let's give it up for my beautiful wife. Here she comes to save the day.
Notices, apparently. Can you guys just click one slide at a time? And then I can keep up with you. All right, iConnect. You want to know another miracle that happened this week? A lot of the information that we had lost has actually miraculously appeared. That's a miracle. But we still need to make sure that you guys are getting emails and updates and notices and just keeping up to date with what's happening. There's a lot happening on in church here. If you're visiting here and would love just to see what events we have on and all that sort of stuff, please, there's an iPad at the back where the iConnect table is. It's very easy to fill in your details. You won't get bombarded, we promise. But we really need your details just to be able to keep you up to date. So if you'd like to stay connected with us, please feel free to, if you need help, just ask somebody to help you with the iPad. But it's all set up for you. You just need to type it in, your details. Awesome. So, oh, that was the screen. That was really easy. All right. Join us, please. We'd love to welcome you to join us at the end of the service for tea and coffee. We know many of you today have families to get to because of Easter, but if you do have time, please stay in fellowship. We'd love to have you. I give. Giving has never been easier. I'm going to hand it over to Gary just to explain how to give via PushPay.
Guys, we found it pretty easy making this transition. And one of the things we've done is we've transitioned to what's called PushPay. And so this is a pretty simple, it's just a simple app that you press. And literally within 10 seconds, you can give your tithes and offerings. You can give whatever you feel you want to give via this app. It comes up as Hillview Community Church, and it takes you to a page. And then you're just able to give. The beautiful thing about this app is you can set up reoccurring offerings. So if you think, oh my gosh, I'm not going to be there every week, or I'd love to just set something up that I don't even have to think about anymore, then you can do that through this app. And so one of the things people have said to us, you know, oh Gary, I don't want to fill something out on a Sunday. It's so simple. There's two easy ways. We have an FBOS machine at the back if you want to do that, or you can use PushPay. And you just go to hillview.org.au/iGive, and it's as simple as that. And so we'll be doing our tithes and offerings in a moment. And also as well, for those watching by YouTube, you can join us as well anywhere in the world, and you can give this morning here at Hillview. Amen?
Amen. He explains it much easier than I do. Do you have a pastoral need? Please, please email us at care@hillview.org.au. If we don't know about something, we actually can't help. So we would love to be able to help you guys. If you have a pastoral need, please just email us at that email address. And it goes to multiple people. So if it's something of a sensitive nature and you just need a phone call from Gary and myself, please just let us know via that email. It's all secure and protected. If it's a pastoral care need, whether you need meals or whether you're going to hospital or some family member or some, you just are in need, please just let us know via there so we can definitely get to that and attend to that. Or please call the office. Come on. All right, Tabernacle Prayer day and night. Night and day. How many of you were here for the first Sunday of February? So a lot of you got the hourglasses. If you haven't got the hourglasses and you know about the prayer initiative that we're doing here at Hillview, they will be made available after the service. They will be in the sound desk, so either Tink or Sam will be around there just to hand them out. This is the now time declaration that we're praying for just 10 minutes, the 10-minute time glasses or hour glasses. It doesn't make sense calling them hour glasses because it's only 10 minutes, but you know. And either in the morning or the afternoon, we're encouraging our congregation and our family to just turn that and declare now time, because that is the time of the Lord. Now time is all about feasting at his table and declaring his promises and releasing what he's declared over Hillview for this year. So we'd encourage you to join us. We will be talking about this again in a couple of weeks' time. So if you missed that Sunday where we actually talked more in detail about it, we will be sharing about it in a couple of weeks' time. And that's it. Oh, YouTube. We are being live streamed, as Gary said, and I'm pretty sure you can go back to it if you want to watch it again. The link is usually up on the Hillview Facebook, and also I'm pretty sure it'll be up on our website as well if you want to get the link to the YouTube.
The other thing about this is if we get 100 subscribers, then we can totally customize our channel. And so I think we got near enough 100 of you this morning. If each and every one of you jump on and subscribe or follow this YouTube channel, as soon as we get to 100, we're able to totally customize it. And so YouTube are like, hey, we don't know who you are in the beginning, but all of a sudden if they get bombarded with, we want to follow this channel as soon as we get to 100. And so guys, if you're watching this morning, please, I encourage you to follow or click subscribe, and then everything will fall into place for that. Some of the other stuff coming up as well, just to let you know, we have Isabel Allen coming here in May. First weekend of May, we have Isabel and Ivan coming. So her husband hasn't been here before. So both her and Isabel, both him and Isabel are going to be here in May. And so we're looking forward to that. Also as well, later on in the year, connected with School of Prophets, we have Catherine Runala coming in August. She's going to be with us. And also as well, Izzy DiGiuzzini is going to be with us as well. And so I'm looking forward. I'm not going to tell you who's coming the rest of the year. You just have to sit back and wait. Amen? But it's going to be an amazing, fun year. And so that said, there's something else I want to put out there this morning. We've got some transitions which we're going to let you know about next week happening here within the life of the church. And they're really exciting and they're really positive. But one of these transitions has highlighted a need for, we need a housekeeper who can come in on a Thursday or a Tuesday or a Thursday, preferably a Thursday, and just do housekeeping stuff. And so we can, if that feels or if that resonates with you today and you're thinking, I can give an hour or 2 hours on a Thursday just to come and help out, then please see myself or Sarah at the end of the service, and we'd just love to talk further with you about that. Amen? Yeah? How many people's ready to give this morning? Awesome. How many people have already downloaded their PushPay app? Woo, check you guys out. My gosh. As soon as you say something, people are like, just download that. I'm already on it, Gary. Awesome. Well, as I said, we're going to give this morning. Are we going to give, Tobias? Are you going to give the offering message? All right, okay, tell him. Okay, buddy. We can do that. Is it? Okay. So we're going to give today. And so I want to encourage you on this Resurrection Sunday not to allow death or the fear of money to come into your life, but make a statement this morning and saying, hey, guess what? Nothing will separate me from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Amen? Nothing. Nothing. No matter what's happening, nothing's going to separate. And so as we give today, as I said, there's an envelope on your seat, or you can use PushPay, or you can use the FPOS machine at the back. I want to invite those that are watching today by also YouTube. You can join us as well in this, but we're going to make a declaration together. Amen? If you prepared your tithes and offerings or you've got your app ready, don't press send yet until we've done this this declaration. Let's all stand in this place. Wow. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Here we go. As we receive today's offering, we are believing you for heaven opened, earth invaded, Storehouses unlocked and miracles created. Dreams and visions, angelic visitations, declarations, signs and wonders with divine manifestations. Anointing, gifting and calls, positions and promotions, provisions and resources to go to the nations. Souls and more souls from every generation, saved and set free, carrying kingdom revelation. Thank you, Father, that as I join my value system to yours, you will pour out favor, blessings, and increase upon me, so I have more than enough to co-labor with heaven and see Jesus get his full reward. Hallelujah and amen. Let's come and give this morning in this place in Jesus' name. Come on. Bless the Lord. Thanks, Harry. If you're wondering this morning why we've using KFC buckets, it's nothing to do with the finger licking offering, amen. It's all to do with a response to a prophetic word that we are a kingdom finance company. And so kingdom finance company. And so that's what we hear this morning. Amen. Lord, we just lift up this offering to you today. Lord, we thank you that every seed that has been sown, Lord God, is going to demonstrate the fruit of the kingdom, the fruit, Lord God, of who you are in our lives and through our lives today. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thanks, Harry. Bless the Lord. One of the things I failed to do at the notice is any birthdays or anniversaries today? We get a chocolate. Come on. Kelsey's 18. Come on. Woo. Check these out. Bless the Lord. There you go. Happy birthday or happy anniversary to you. It's amazing. So good. Amen. Well, guys, I want to jump straight into the word. Because I feel like God wants to blow this place up at the end. Amen. And so I'm going to jump into teaching. And then we'll see what God does. Yeah. I don't know about you, but I'm excited. I determined in my heart that the ball would be pitched and I would knock this out by 11:30. Can we do that? Can we be signed, sealed, and delivered by 11:30? Do you think that's possible? All things are possible to those that believe. Do you believe this morning in a miracle? That's one thing someone told me once. Gary, when you preach, don't use these lines. And I close with this. Because that can mean another 15 minutes. Or this is my last point. Or I'm going to be done in 5 minutes. You know, you can't use these lines. And so, but I want to say this morning, I feel like the word is going to become flesh and dwell amongst us this morning. There's something tangible that the Lord wants to do amongst us that I believe is going to add fabric to our lives so that we can't just be a people who speak about resurrection. We are a people who live resurrection. We're not a people who just know about it. We're the people who have witnessed it. Amen? That we can be witnesses of the truth that he said that on the third day he would rise again, and he has. Yeah? And so let's put our hands on our hearts and pray this prayer together. Pray this prayer. Father, speak to my heart and change my life. Father, we just welcome the spirit of wisdom and revelation to come, Lord, as we unlock these scriptures, as we unpack these scriptures, Lord, we thank you today, Lord, that you are good and your loving kindnesses endure forever. Amen? Amen. Bless the Lord. Well, I'm excited this morning because I don't just want to teach about or unpack about resurrection, but I want to give us some time. I want to give us some context. Amen? I want to give us some understanding that I believe that doesn't bring us into this once a year, whoa, it's Easter, I better get to church. Or it's Easter, I better, you know, talk about his resurrection. I believe that everything Jesus did was an invitation to have a daily encounter of in our lives. Amen? This is what Paul said. He said, that I may know him, the fellowship of his sufferings, and the power of his resurrection. Fellowship means to know intimately, to be with. And so we recognize in that for us to know the fellowship of his sufferings isn't to suffer. It's to have a knowledge of or an understanding of, yeah? But the revelation comes when we step into the power of resurrection. And the power of resurrection doesn't mean something that's dead now becomes alive. The power of resurrection of what Jesus did was a demonstration of us coming into the union again with God. And I'm going to unpack to you right now that Genesis 1, 2, and 3 was all connected to the very fact of Jesus rising again. And so it wasn't an encounter for us to just be reunited with God. It wasn't just a restoring of relationship. I'll tell you what it was. It was a restoring of us back to the place where we can walk with him again in the cool of the day. Yeah. And so we're going to pick it up in John 20, but I want you to understand something. This has troubled me, and it troubled me, and this was one of the things that came out of me being atheist, getting saved, and coming into the revelation of not just who he is, but whose I am. And so not about who I am or whose I am, but who he is in my life. And you know, one of the things that troubled me, and I wasn't good at maths, but I'm sure I sort of recognized this, that if Jesus died on a Friday, then the third day isn't Sunday. And so I'm perplexed because I'm in a place now where what I'm told and what I see are two different things. And so I now must come back to the place of actually recognizing that it wasn't actually connected to days, it was connected to feasts. That everything Jesus did wasn't connected to a timeline of man, it was connected to the timeline of God. And so we recognize, and this is why I want to encourage you today in the prophetic, is when God speaks over your life, don't bring a Kairos promise into a Kronos environment. That when he says to you, I'm going to do this in the coming days, don't count down Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday and say, God, when are you doing this? Because one of the things we got to recognize, the danger is we take Kairos encounters and we try to put them in Kronos environments. Let me put this as a side adage. I encourage people never to put a date on their prophetic words. I ask people all the time. I was talking to a great pastor friend of mine the other day, and I said to him, hey, do you read your prophetic words? Because I tell you, it's phenomenal. You see his book, it's like that. I said, are they chronologically, you know, put out in this book? And he said, yes. I said, so you can go back to 1983 and you can tell me a word you had. Oh, you bet you I can. And literally, he opens it up and he's got it all indexed by time. And I said, buddy, I'm about to rock your world. And I took that index page and I ripped it out. And he's like, what are you doing? I said, let me invite you into the kairos of God, God's time. I said, this is the danger we have. I said, someone gives us a word in 1983 about how we can have apostolic influence. And you might not get a word like that until 1994. But you've gone through all these other words now about different things in your life. And sometimes these words come in seasons and out of seasons. And so what I encouraged him to do, and I said, you know, you don't have to do this. Get your PA to do it. But take your prophetic words and begin to group them in theme, not time. Because the Bible says, where two or three agree, what happens? It shall be established. When you connect prophetic words together, you have an ability for each word to begin to agree with itself. So I encouraged him. He came back to me and goes, look, I looked at the words and literally, this was amazing, color-coded. I'm like, okay, you had to do a color. And so literally he connected every word or grouped them in colors. So red talked about this and yellow talked about this. But the phenomenal thing was when I jumped into something like the apostolic, every word I read one after the other, what did it speak about? It spoke about the apostolic. And so I want to encourage you, friend, don't group your words by time. Group your words by this place of this is what I'm saying, this is what I'm releasing over you. Amen? And this is the beautiful thing we find in Scripture. All the words about Jesus are all grouped together, one after the other, in Isaiah, in Jeremiah, in Ezekiel. Yeah? Am I speaking to somebody? And so when you take your words and you begin to group them based on theme, all of a sudden everything you begin to read agrees with itself. And what happens when it agrees? It gets established. And so Jesus, when Jesus gets, you know, killed, when he gets crucified, we have to realize this timeline. Let me share with you this timeline. You see, Jesus institutes the Last Supper. You see, he does this Last Supper just before dawn, just before dusk. He institutes the Lord's Supper. During that night, he gets betrayed by Judas. That very night, he gets arrested in the garden. And this is where we see some chopping going on. Amen? This is where we see Peter take his sword and go, pew, and this guy's ear falls off. And I don't know about you, but if I was a policeman, and my ear just got chopped off, and the guy I'm coming to arrest picks up my ear and puts it back on, I don't think I'd arrest him, would you? But you know what this proves to me? Is the fear of man was more powerful than the demonstration of the miraculous. That they had an order. They had a fear of Pontius Pilate. And their fear of Pontius Pilate was greater than the demonstration of the miracles they saw that day. Can I suggest to you that maybe fear is the very thing that is stopping you celebrating the miraculous in your life? And the very thing that deals with fear is perfect love. Yeah? And so Jesus gets arrested. And then it says he gets taken before Pontius Pilate. And Pontius Pilate totally washes his hands. And according to this, they're about to enter the High Sabbath. What's the High Sabbath? The High Sabbath was the most important Sabbath of that month. And they entered this High Sabbath, and it was on the High Sabbath. And on the High Sabbath, it wasn't just a morning and an evening sacrifice, but there had to be a Passover lamb as well. And so the High Sabbath was the beginning of Passover. And on High Sabbath, there wasn't just a morning and evening. There was a Passover lamb that was also offered as well. How many crosses were on Golgotha that day? Three. And you know, this is the amazing thing about what happened. The one on his right said to him, I realize who you are. Please save me. And what did Jesus turn and say to him? Today, you will be with me in paradise. You see, this is the great thing about the sacrifice. He was the morning sacrifice. Why? Because he was sacrificed in light. The illumination of the revelation of Jesus came upon him. But the one on his left was the evening sacrifice. Why? Because he died in the dark. But who was in the middle? Jesus, the Passover lamb. And so all of a sudden we have a morning and we have an evening sacrifice and we have the Passover lamb in the middle. And this is the beautiful thing. And if you connect this with the revelation that Jesus said, no man takes my life from me, but I give it. This is a whole nother teaching that I do on the priesthood. But Jesus didn't just hang there as the lamb. He also hung there as the priest. And there's a whole nother message I can go into, but I'm not this morning because I haven't got time. But he was able to offer his life. Why? Because he was a priest and not just the sacrifice. That's why he said, I give my life freely. And so when Jesus, the beginning of high Passover or high, you know, this place of high Sabbath actually is a Thursday. The high Sabbath begins on a Thursday. And so Jesus was crucified on a Thursday. And I tell you, I've had people when I've taught this come up to me and say, this is sacrilege. How can you teach this? And I said, because it makes sense. It's scriptural. Because he said 3 days. And I don't think Jesus, I know he was a carpenter, not a mathematician, but I'm sure Jesus wasn't bad at maths either. Amen? He had to cut 45 angles, yeah? And so when Jesus says this, so we realize that Jesus gets crucified and gets buried. And he gets buried in a rich man's tomb. But one of the things they didn't have time for is you couldn't touch the body for 3 days. There had to be a 3-day window before you could come and bring spices or bring things that would literally bring an offering. And this is what we pick up in John chapter 20. Is Mary Magdalene is on her way to bring spices or to bring an offering to the tomb. And it says that Jesus is in the tomb for 3 days and 3 nights. High Sabbath, coming into Passover. But do you know what happened just after that particular Passover? Do you know what the celebration was? It was the celebration of first fruits. The reason Jesus rose on the third day, which was the day of first fruits, was because he was the first fruits offering. He came as the first fruits that nothing else could compare to what he offered that day. And the first fruits offering, and we all know about first fruits, about giving in expectancy of what is to come. He gave his life knowing that his life would absolutely pay the ransom for every sin committed on the face of this earth. Amen? And as Graham Cook so beautifully articulated in our launch of School of Prophets, was Jesus' sacrifice enough? Then why do we keep thinking we need to pay? Was the full wrath of God placed on Jesus? Yes, it was. Then there's none left for you. Yeah? And so one of the things that I love about this, and we're going to pick this up in John chapter 20. This is my favorite. I tell you, I love John chapter 20. The empty tomb. Now, on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene. So first day of the week, this is now first fruits week. On the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Jesus was the first rolling stone. Amen? Come on. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and the other disciple, being John, whom Jesus loved. I love this. I love this. Who's the author of this book? You see, my wife always says to me, Gary, you're the hero of your own story. Well, of course, it's my story. Amen? And it's the same with John here. And I'm going to pick out little bits in this passage that just demonstrate that there's healthy competition in God. Amen? And so we see here, then she ran and came to the disciple and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, they have taken away the Lord out of the tomb and we do not know where they have laid him. And Peter therefore went out and the other disciple and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together and the other disciple outran Peter. What? This is like the infallible word of God. Amen? This is inspired by God, but yet we have some healthy competition going on here. And the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first. I'm just going to put it in there, Peter. I actually outran you and I came to the tomb first. Let me just drop it in there in verse 4 of chapter 20. So we have John 20, chapter 4. What's it all about? It's all about brotherly competition. Yeah? How many people know God isn't serious, but he's serious about you? Yeah? And he, stooping down and looking in, saw the linen cloths lying there, but yet did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. And he saw the linen cloths lying there, and the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded together in a place by itself. We have to understand something, you guys. I want to interject this. We see that the body and the head cloth of Jesus was in two different places. And there's a reason for that. And the reason for that can be found in Ephesians. You see, the Bible says in Ephesians that God has given some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the equipping of the saints for the works of service until we all come to a maturity in Christ. Not being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine, but growing up into Christ the head. Everyone say growing up into Christ the head. So the reason for the fivefold ministry, the reason that the body and the head cloth of Jesus was separate is because the fivefold mandate upon the church is to bring the head and the body of Christ back together. Am I speaking to somebody? And so we have the head cloth and the body cloth in separate places. And the mandate from Ephesians 4 is to bring the head and the body back together, growing up into the head, which is Christ. Let me tell you something right now. Apostles are not head of the church. Prophets are not head of the church. They're the foundations. Amen? Christ is the head. I don't come to your house and go, man, I love your foundations. Whew. Good Lord. Ray, you have got gorgeous foundations. I'm loving these foundations. You don't. You celebrate what's built in them. Amen? And that is the mark of true fivefold ministry. When people celebrate what's built on them, they don't celebrate them. Yeah? Now, you're my heart, you. There is a celebration of the fivefold. But we don't go around going, oh, they're amazing. I tell you, every true fivefold minister I've ever met has people on their shoulders to say, go further than I've gone. Be more than I've ever been. Yeah, am I speaking to somebody? So we're connecting. For as yet, they did not know the scripture that he must rise again from the dead. Then the disciples went out away again to their homes. But Mary stood outside the tomb, weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. Can I tell you what this is a demonstration of? This is Jacob's ladder right here. This is a demonstration of Jacob's ladder right here. Why? That the angels are at the head and they're at the feet. What did Jesus say to Nathanael? Surely I say to you, there's no guile, but you will see angels ascend and descend upon the Son of Man. Yeah? There's a demonstration right here of Jacob's ladder. And one of the things I want to encourage us today is sometimes we can be so hasty and we can be so quick in coming and saying, oh, God, what are you doing? What has happened to you? Someone could share a testimony and we could come and be like, oh, that's awesome. Let's go back and have some breakfast. But something about Mary shifted something. She remained at the tomb. But she didn't just remain at the tomb. She was weeping. And I want to tell you something right now. Do you know what tears are? Well, Gary, I can give you the scientific explanation of what, and the medical explanation of what tears are. Now, let me tell you what tears are to the Lord. They're an offering. Tears are an offering. Tears, I tell you, tears are like oil. They cause the hard things, the stuck things to become loosed. Amen? And there was something powerful about her weeping. And it says, and she saw the angels. Then they said to her, woman, why are you weeping? She said to them, because they have taken away my Lord, and I did not know where they have laid him. Now when she said this, she turned around and saw. Everyone say saw. Saw Jesus. Wow. Standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. I want to tell you something right now. The word saw there doesn't just mean became visible. Do you know the word saw there? Do you know what the root word for the saw there is? Is the word theatrica or theoreo. Literally means, which means theater. It means theater. When she turned around and saw Jesus, all of a sudden she had an encounter with the theater of salvation. She didn't just encounter him. She didn't just say, oh, well, that's nice, there's Jesus. Literally displayed to her was the theater or the production of the very story of why he died and rose again. And I love this next verse. Verse 15. Then Jesus said to him, woman, why are you weeping? I tell you, this is the worst thing you can say to a woman. She must have lost it. Because I tell you, when I say, honey, why are you weeping? Shh. Can't you just hug me? Sorry. Twice this woman's asked, honey, why are you weeping? The angels ask her, and then Jesus asks her, woman, why are you crying? You see, it's the masculine thing. We don't understand tears, do we? So the angels rock up, and they're like, why are you weeping? What are you crying for? And then Jesus rocks up, woman, why are you weeping? I don't know about you, but if I put myself for a moment in Mary Magdalene's, it's like, really, can't I just be emotional for a minute? I tell you, the hardest thing is when you say to a woman, why are you crying? And they turn back and say, I don't know. I don't know about you, but my mind at that moment goes into this crunch, like, there's got to be a reason. And then you start questioning yourself. You're like, have I done something? And then you start the production line of presents. You come with a rose, or you come with a cup of tea, and you're like, and they still cry, and you're like, what's wrong? Women, I want to free you. It's okay for you to cry, amen? Men, it's okay for you to cry as well, yeah? Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? And she, supposing him to be the gardener. This verse complexed me for quite a while, because I don't know about you, but every time I see the pictures of resurrected Christ, he's like floating 4 foot off the ground, dressed in white, and it's like, oh! Like it's glowing, isn't it? But when Jesus encountered Mary Magdalene, she thought he was the gardener. She didn't think he was a stranger. She didn't think he was just some random. She supposed him to be the gardener. Why? Because the very mandate of Jesus was to restore us to the garden. The reason she thought him to be the gardener is because the very mandate upon Jesus was to restore us to the garden. It wasn't just to restore us to the Father. It was to restore us to the garden. That the very, you see, this is what I love about God. God doesn't just create you. God doesn't just speak over you. God doesn't just declare over you. God will always give you a context and prepare a context for the destiny that's on your life. I'll tell you something. Sometimes when you don't know where you are, I want to encourage you. Where you are is maybe a clue to who you are. Let me try this side, because this side's not getting it. Let me encourage you. When you don't know what you're doing, where you're going, maybe a glimpse of where you are is a glimpse and a clue to who you are. Because he's called us to walk with him. He's called, you see, God created the world in 6 days, and then created the world in 5 days, created man, and then rested. God created in 5 days. On the sixth day, he created us. Five speaks of grace. God will always give you a context of grace for the calling that's upon your life. He didn't just come and say, oh, well, I got a good idea. Let's make man. He prepared a place for man. The same way as Jesus told the disciples to go and wait in Jerusalem until you're endued with power, they waited 50 days. Why? Because God will always require a place where he wants to release his power. God will always require a person to demonstrate his power. He doesn't just demonstrate it. And I want to encourage you today, whenever God speaks to you, whenever God releases who he is to you, he'll always provide a context first. And this is the beautiful thing about resurrection. Jesus provided the context. The context was he looked like a gardener. He wasn't floating 4 feet and dressed in white. I just like to think, oh my gosh, this sounds like Talladega Nights. I just like to think of my Jesus in, you know, in dungarees or something. Imagine Jesus just standing there in dungarees. Because I don't know, the last time I saw a gardener, they had dungarees on with one of these straw hats. I was in America, mind, but I know what gardeners look like. Maybe Peter Stokes. Who's Peter Stokes? Peter Stokes is a gardener. You see, he looked like a gardener. And the reason he looked like a gardener is because he was postured to restore us to the garden. Am I speaking to somebody? And so what does going to the garden look like? I'll tell you what it looks like. It's where God plants life in the center of you. It says that he took the tree of life and planted it in the center of the garden. I'll tell you what going back to the garden looks like. It means life is planted back in the center of you. It means that the very invitation of us walking with him again in the cool of the day comes. And this is what I love. She's supposing him to be a gardener. This is what she said. If whatever you've done with him, please tell me and I'll go and get him. And Jesus said to her, and this is what I love. Look at that. Sometimes you have to just say their name to get them, you know, in the right, you know, get them. Whatever, I got to be careful here because I'm treading on ground. But it says, Mary, with an exclamation mark. What does that mean? It doesn't mean Mary. Mary with an exclamation mark is like, Mary. Eugene, is that right? If you see an exclamation mark in a script, what is it? Emphasize. Let's do the best emphasizing. Mary. And sometimes, you know, when you see women who are weeping or ecstatic, sometimes you got to go, hey. And this is what had to happen here. Jesus had to go, Mary. Not in a cruel way, not in an abusive way, but just in a, listen, love. Let me get the salts out, amen? Mary. And as soon as he said her name, she came to her right senses and said, Rabboni, which means teacher. All of a sudden now, he goes from being gardener to being teacher. Why? Because a gardener will always prepare a place. A teacher will always give you the description or give you the understanding of the place. Can I say that again? The gardener prepares the place, but it takes a teacher to give you the understanding of the place. And this is what he moved from just being gardener now to being teacher to say, hey, I'm restoring you to a place that I've provided, but let me describe what this place is. Let me give you an understanding, because when you get an understanding, it allows you to stand under what God's doing. Am I speaking to somebody? And Jesus said to her, do not cling to me. And this is the other thing I love about women. They get emotional and clingy, amen? No, you're my heart. I'm not having a thing. This is what I love. This is what I love. When you're in this place of, listen, I just want to be here for you. All of a sudden, it's like, come here. I'm like, okay. But I'm okay with physical touch, amen? And so this is what we find here. Jesus brings this woman into empowerment, and the first thing she does is she just wants to grab him. But he says to her, don't cling to me. Don't cling to me. Why? Because he couldn't be Mary's first fruit. He had to be God's first fruit. He couldn't be given to Mary. He had to be given to the Lord. Why? Because he said, I haven't ascended to my father or your father yet. And this is the beautiful thing here. And this is what I love about Mary. And this is what killed the Welsh revival, guys, is when Evan Roberts was accused of being too emotional. This is what killed the revival. He was branded as an emotionalist. I want to tell you right now, God and emotion go together. And this is what I love about the feminine aspect of God or why. Do you realize, and this is what bugs me, is when you see all through, our history, how women have been suppressed in the context of church, when, guys, 9 times out of 10, every encounter that happened in Scripture happened with a woman. Am I speaking to somebody? I told you I'd get points back. You're on my side now. But I want to encourage you right now, emotionalism is not demonic, it's heavenly. And the reason why, Zephaniah 3:17, it says, the Lord your God is in your midst, the mighty one will save. He will joy over you or rejoice over you with gladness. The word joy, the root word for joy there, literally means to spin under violent emotion. When you worship the Lord, he doesn't just sit there and go, come on, bring it on. Literally, Zephaniah 3:17 tells us that he gets off his throne and begins to spin under violent emotion. That's what the root word for rejoice or joy is. Am I speaking to somebody? And so I want to permission us today in this place that resurrection power has got nothing to do with just Jesus rising from the dead. It's got everything with you being restored to the garden. It's got everything about you being restored back to your heart. It's got everything to do with you getting an understanding that God loves you, that he died for you, that he rose again for you. But more than that is that you can connect with him again by who you are. Yeah? And I feel like this morning, all over this world, you know, it's Resurrection Sunday. And guys, hear my heart when I say this. I unreservedly, I totally honor the resurrection of Jesus Christ. But I want to tell you something. Jesus Christ celebrates your resurrection. Because it wasn't just about him raising. It was about you raising up as well. And this Resurrection Sunday is not just a Sunday where we celebrate a son being risen. We get to celebrate sons being risen. Sorry, ladies, if I got to be a bride, you can be a son. Amen? But I feel like this morning, God wants to unlock something in us. That this resurrection revelation doesn't just come to us every year, but comes with us every day. That we walk into dead situations like I did yesterday and think, my gosh, it's time for this to get resurrected. That we walk into impossible situations and we think, this just needs a bit of resurrection. That we walk and we hear about people's plights and circumstances and situations and we just put our arm around them and say, hey, we just need a bit of resurrection. Turn to your neighbor and say, let's have a bit of resurrection. Let's have a bit of resurrection. Am I speaking to somebody? Yeah? And so what does that look like, friend? You see, what that looks like is that we don't get into a place of thinking that we're just celebrating. I tell you, you are celebrated today. This Resurrection Sunday is as much about you as it is about Jesus. And I don't say that on my own authority because I know his heart for us. That he is so thankful. Why? Hebrews 12, verse 1, verse 2, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising its shame, and is now seated at the right hand of the Father. The very reason for Resurrection Sunday is one, that you were the joy set before him. Two, that he came to despise any kind of shame in your life. And three, to posture and position you at the right hand of the Father. So that whatever we do in life, we know that we are seated in him in heavenly places. Amen? Am I speaking to somebody? Let's have the worship team back up this morning. Thank you, Father. Woo! Thank you, Lord. Thank you. I feel this morning, I don't know why, but I feel like this morning God wants to stir. You know, Paul said to Timothy, I remind you to stir up the gift of God that's in you, that it was given to you by the laying on of hands. That you have not been given the spirit of fear, but love, power and a sound mind. And I feel like this morning, in this record-breaking time of 11:22, for the next 8 minutes, sorry, that's Kronos. For the next eternity, amen? From now until eternity, or now and eternity, that God wants to give us another revelation of resurrection. And I feel like tonight, today, that something that was dead is about to become alive. That was dormant is about to be realized. And guys, I'm not asking for dreams to be resurrected today. Because I'll tell you, all dreams need a dreamers. And all dreamers need a dreams. I'm not asking today for hopes to be resurrected. What I'm asking for this morning is that the true you would be resurrected in this place. That you would come alive. That God would make you come alive. Because that's what He does. The Bible says that the same power, everyone say power, dunamis, the same power that raised Christ from the dead dwells in us and quickens. The word quicken there literally means to be a catalyst. That which would take a year could take a month. That which took a month can take a day. The word quicken literally means outside of time frame or outside of regular time. And this same power that raised Christ from the dead quickens your mortal body. And so that which is mortal, God wants to quicken right now. Amen? So let's stand in this place together. And I want us to put our hands on our hearts. And I feel like there's like this defibrillator anointing here today. Amen? Some of you are going to feel shocked walking out of here because it's like, my gosh, I feel totally different. This is what the anointing does. This is what the anointing does. It makes cowards courageous. It makes the weak strong. It makes the dead alive. It makes the sick healed. It makes the impoverished prosper. It makes the lonely embraced. It makes the lost found. It makes the blind to see. It makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak. It causes the prisoner to be a free man. It invites the bondservant to walk free. It causes lepers to become kings. Woo! This is resurrection power. It makes the destitute a destiny. So right now where you are, just let resurrection power fall on you. Shandaraba. It makes slaves sons. And those that are destitute daughters. Like you've been walking around in grave clothes, I'm going to invite you to come and take off the grave clothes this morning. and say, I'm done with dead living. I don't want to be a dead man walking. I want to be a resurrected son or daughter. Friend, if that's you this morning, I invite you to come. Right now, there's resurrection. I want to invite you to come and I want to pray for you. If you're done with the grave clothes, then come and take them off this morning in this place. Sha-la-ba-ba-ba. You're just welcome. You're so welcome. You're so welcome. Just come forward. Give room for others. Thank you, Lord. Misogyny, or you've been wearing the grave clothes of intimidation, I want you to come right now, because God is, I tell you, as soon as I prayed for this woman, the phrase came to me, woman, thou art loosed. And I feel like the Lord wants to loose some women here this morning in this place. Grave clothes are coming off. If that's you, just come. Just come. And the men amongst us, if you feel like you've been in grave clothes, then come in Jesus' name.
How wide, how deep this love that you gave us. How wide, how deep this love that has saved us. How wide, how deep this love that you gave us. How wide, how deep. Cause you tore the veil and you made a way. We are one. We are one. Cause you tore the veil and you made a way. We are one.
Nothing, nothing.
Separate us. Nothing can ever separate us. How high, how wide, how deep this love that you gave us. How high, how deep this love that has saved us. And how high, how deep this love that you gave us. How high, how wide.
You talk.
Cause you tore the veil and you made a way.
Yeah. on YouTube, I just declare over you, loosed. I just take all the grave clothes off you right now. And I declare you loosed. No longer held by the grave clothes of the past, but you have robes of righteousness on you right now. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Jesus' name, I declare over you freedom, 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 freedom. Let's lift our hands in this place and let's declare this together. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Women, thou art loosed. Men, you are free. And Father, right now, we just invite the angels to come and to take the grave clothes away. There's only one place for grave clothes, and that's the fire. And so each and every one of you are clothed in righteousness, that you put on Christ. Welcome to the wardrobe of God. In Jesus' name. Come on, you tore the veil. Yeah, you tore.
And you tore the veil. You made a way. We are one. We are one.
Come
tore.
On, yeah.
You tore the veil. You made a way. We are one. We are one. You tore the veil. We are.
Father, today we thank you that we leave this place celebrating and celebrated for this Resurrection Sunday. Truly, you have brought many sons to glory and many daughters to destiny. So, Father, right now I pray over each and every one in this place as we go. Lord, let the commission be filled that we are witnesses in Roeville, in Melbourne, Victoria, Australia, and the uttermost parts of the earth. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Bless you guys. Have a great rest of your Sunday. Keep being ministered to by God. And we look forward to seeing you next Sunday. In Jesus' name, bless you.